When President Carter asked Europe for help, he was making his appeal to friends. Well, this afternoon, the European Parliament in Strasbourg tested that friendship. Llew Gardner is there now with three of the Euro MPs.
Mr. Scott Hopkins, there was not much cheer for the Americans in today's debate. They want tough action, trade sanctions, and the breaking of diplomatic ties. You offer them words and precious little action.
No, I think that is absolutely the wrong conclusion to draw from what happened. I think the Americans should be very content with what has happened in the European Parliament. We've given them the maximum support for the situation they find themselves in. We've offered to help as far as the economic sanctions are concerned, and indeed we've gone as far as talking about breaking off diplomatic relations should the hostages not be released. What more can they ask for?
Mr. Scott Hopkins, they want a trade embargo now. They want diplomatic relations cut off. You are not proposing to do that at this moment.
Certainly we are recommending to the Council of Ministers, who are meeting on Monday, that these actions should be within the compass of the nine countries of the European community, if they so decide. This is surely what is the request from the Americans. I think you got it the wrong way round. I think we have gone as far as, if not even further, than I think the Americans hoped we would. And we don't forget, we're speaking for 250 million people throughout Europe, which is a tremendous slice of population.
I'll come back to you, Mr. Scott Hopkins. Madam Scrivener, you voted for the motion, but I know you have some reservations about the American position.
Well, you're right, but I think that what is very important is that all European countries try and adopt a common position. This is more important than anything else, because as you said, we are talking about
60 million.
Madam, if I may interrupt you, may I ask you, are you in favor of trade sanctions? Are you in favor of cutting off diplomatic relations?
Well, I will talk about history, and in history, embargo never was useful.
So you're not in favor.
So
of it.
Maybe it's, not very much, not very much. But I am very much in favor of an action of all the different countries in common market.
Herr Hensch, are you in favor of diplomatic relations being broken off? Are you in favor of a trade embargo?
If these measures prevent America from a military solution, I am for, because what is necessary now is to get more time to prevent the United States to be involved in a way with no return.
May I put however to you, Herr Hensch, the socialists in Parliament today seem to be saying that there have been sufficient resolutions on this subject, that they had not a lot of sympathy for this kind of tough diplomacy, yet Chancellor Schmidt is believed to be the American's strongest supporter. Does that put you in an awkward position?
I don't think that this was a problem, the number of resolutions of the socialist group and the position of the Chancellor Helmut Schmidt. I think it's absolutely necessary that the nine, that the European community develops a joint position.
Yeah, right.
Common policy and a common diplomacy in this case. And I think first to the solidarity to the United States is the solidarity of the European people. We are the friend and the allies of the United States.
But you're not doing, if I may put it to you, Herr Hensch, you are not doing what they ask you to do.
You're wrong. We are doing what they're asking
us to do. Yes, that's right. But we are their allies, but we have to be consulted before for the steps.
That's the point.
And we have the right and the duty to prevent them to make mistakes.
You think they are making a mistake?
Yes, sometimes. I think
surely
so.
What we are really after is we're trying to arrange that the American hostages in Tehran are released by giving our support to the Americans and the actions they're taking. This is what we have done today. We, and I'm entirely in agreement with my two colleagues here, we want to stop the situation drifting into a war. That's what we're up to.
All right, thank you.
And to do that, we've taken these actions today, and you'd be quite wrong, you really are wrong, if you're saying this were weak actions and not what was necessary in the circumstances. It was the best we could do, and I think it was a very good best, too.
Madam, we cannot be more American than the Americans.
Madam Hedge.
Madam Scrivener, pardon.
One must not forget that the United States of America did not discuss with us their plans before.
Right at the beginning they didn't, but they have done since then. I think it's unfair to say that they haven't done since. You're quite right. When this started, America didn't. This is true, and President Carter took action straight away. But since then, they have been consulting through our ambassadorial links in our various countries. They have been.
Mr. Scott Hopkins, let me interrupt you and ask Madam Scrivener this. If the foreign secretaries do not do what the Americans have asked for, and they have asked not for words, not for promises in the future, they have asked for trade embargo, they have asked for, President Carter is asking tonight for the diplomatic relations to be broken off. If you do not do that, won't you create a breach between Europe and America that would take a long time to heal?
Well, you know, my opinion is we are in the same camp. Of course, we are in the same freedom camp. The only thing is that, of course, the problems in United States are not exactly the same that they are in Europe, and everybody has to understand that. And after all, we can help United States, maybe more, if we have another attitude than if we exactly are doing what we are asking to do. We don't refuse at all to help. We want to help. We are with these people. But please don't think that we have to, we are not in an army, we have not to do such and such thing because we are us, but we are in the same camp and we want to help them.
Are you all in the same camp, Herr Henry?
Perhaps not exactly. I think the pity is that things might come to a point where we must follow the United States, even when we know, if we know that it's a wrong way, and that's the danger in this situation we live now.
What we're trying to do is to avoid the situation where the Americans get themselves into a kind of position where we drift into war, and they can't get back.
It almost sounds, Mr. Scott Hopkins, that we know better than the Americans how to handle this thing.
We don't. But what we do know, and I'm old enough to remember how we drifted into the last war, or how we went into it. And my goodness, we don't want to get into another one now. And so if we can do anything to help our Americans so they don't get that sort of situation, and what we have done now is to help them to say that we will, yes, impose economic embargoes if their hostages aren't released. Yes, we will consider breaking off diplomatic relations if the hostages aren't released. That is the support.
Scott Hopkins are asking you to do it now. They're not asking you to wait.
But the Parliament can't do it. It's up to the foreign ministers to do it. We've recommended that they should.
I don't agree with you, because in politics, you know that everything is changing every day.
Madam, it's the Americans you don't agree with, not me.
Yes, of course. But I want to say that things are changing. And the best example is that President Carter, and I don't blame him because everything is so difficult, he's changing his mind quite often. I don't blame him, but one day he thinks that the best decision is maybe to do that, and the other day he's doing something else.
I think our task is to show to the Americans that we are in a situation not of before the last war, but before the First World War in July 1914.
That's right.
That's a historical reference.
Yeah.
And I think we should do all not to repeat history.
Oh, yes.
To drift into the war.
We all agree.
Let me go around you in the last minute now very quickly and ask you, what do you think the foreign secretaries will do on Tuesday? Will they accord with the Americans, or will they hedge their bets?
They will hedge their bets.
I think they will hedge their bets.
I think one or two may, but I hope the majority won't. Certainly, judging from your Chancellor, the Federal Chancellor's statements, and my own Prime Minister's statements, Margaret Thatcher, I don't think that the majority will hedge. I hope they don't.
Madame, gentlemen, thank you very much indeed. From a not totally united as yet Europe, from a somewhat fearful Europe, which thinks perhaps that the Americans need some help and advice in this matter. Good night from here, and back to Denis Tuohy in the studio.
Well, following today's debate in Strasbourg, how will next week's meeting of the European Council of Ministers affect the chances of the hostages in Tehran being released? With me now are Ali Afrouz, chargé d'affaires of the Embassy of the Islamic Republic of Iran in London, and Leonard Downey, London correspondent of the Washington Post, which takes the editorial line that this whole question is a litmus test of the Atlantic Alliance. Mr. Afrouz, if the EEC does what America wants and imposes economic sanctions, will that help to free the hostages?
Not at all, because the fate of hostage will be decided by the new Islamic parliament, which is due to meet probably next month.
Why do you think that the United States should be prepared to wait for that, given that there already has been a problem in getting the government of Iran to take over responsibility for the hostages?
Well, U.S. administration does not have to wait. The hostage could be released tomorrow if the U.S. administration, President Carter, give the Shah back to Iranian revolutionary people, because the base still the basic demand of the Shah is the extradition of the deposed Shah and all the assets which actually belongs to the Iranian people would be happened, and then any time immediately will be released.
If the United States, though, is not prepared to do that, what if she tightens the screw further? What if she bans food and medical supplies being exported to Iran and even moves to the length of a naval blockade?
Well, actually, I'm not denying there will be some difficulties for our people, but as a revolutionary nation, our people will tolerate economic sanction, even the military action, to keep the revolution going and for the sake of the nation's freedom, independency. This is for us more important than to bear any economical sanction like that.
Well, can I bring in Leonard Downey at this point? Having listened to Mr. Afrouz, do you think that what's the course that President Carter has embarked upon, the new tough approach, is likely to secure the release of the hostages?
That's very difficult to say, and I think that even the people who are deciding on this policy in Washington are not sure precisely what effect it may have on the actions of Iran, but they feel a strong necessity to respond to a growing mood of impatience among the American people about this. The opinion polls are showing that people are becoming more and more restless, both with the failure to have anything done about the hostages in Iran, and also with what is perceived there as a failure by a number of other countries in the world to care about the fact that this situation has not been solved.
Do you think it is still the priority of the American government, above all else, to secure the release of the hostages, or is there perhaps a mood of the need to punish Iran for what is regarded as a serious breach of international law?
It's open to argument, but I think that by and large Americans want to see these people home first and foremost. I don't think that there's that strong anti-Iranian feeling as such in the United States any longer. I think that wore itself out pretty early after the event, that the impatience now is with getting these people home, and once that happened, I think that would people would move on to other problems.
One wonders whether, even if the Iranian government, Mr. Afrouz, were to be persuaded of the need to release the hostages, whether they have the authority to so do, whether they have the authority to persuade the captors to hand them over. Could they?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, yes, the Iranian new parliament, which represent the whole 35 million nation, they will decide. They have the authority to decide on the faith of the hostages.
But why was it that when the president of the country was trying to negotiate that the hostages be transferred to the custody of the government as such, that the negotiations for that broke down?
Because I don't believe the government should keep the hostages, because that's not the business of government. This was taken by the people, students, military students, Islamic students. They did that. That was actually a reaction because of the, again, invitation of the deposed Shah by President Carter, so-called ill, but I think it was a political ill than physically ill, to United States. That was actually a reaction. And still, there's a people's will that the hostage should be kept until the parliament to decide what happened. Although I don't blame the American people to be impatient, to waiting so long, and our people have been waiting so long too to actually to receive the deposed Shah, because American people, unfortunately, are being kept, most cases, ignorant.
But they're not necessarily supporters of the Shah, the American people.
No, they are not, but they are kept ignorant. They don't know the President Carter, what for what reason, invited the Shah and then transferred to, from Panama. By the time came our lawyers, they were fighting, they were working the case for the extradition of the deposed Shah, and then immediately Shah was transferred to Cairo.
Mr. Afruz and Mr. Downey, thank you at least for indicating the extent of the gulf that exists between the views of the United States and Iran. So next week, the European Council of Ministers, the week after that, the European Summit, and who knows what next and when from Washington. The story grows more ominous as it gathers momentum, and more agonizing for the hostages themselves as they face tomorrow, their 167th day of detention in Tehran. From TVI, good night.